All right, this is John Cole with growingyourgreens.com. Today we have another exciting episode for you. Where we're at today is at the National Heirloom Expo. Now, I told you guys should have came out here because I can't cover everything in this video for you guys. You know, there's only one of me and there's a lot of the Heirloom Expo to see, so I'm not going to be able to cover all the different areas. But what I will do in this video is kind of give you guys a glimpse of what it would have been like if you were here, and just hopefully a short, under 15 minute video. But I have problems with short videos. They're always pretty long, so maybe it'll end up even a half hour or something. But anyways, without further ado, let's go ahead and go inside and shoot with you guys what the 2014 National Heirloom Expo is like. And you want to be sure to mark your calendar for next year, because they will be having it again next year, probably around the same time, September 2015, here in beautiful Santa Rosa, California. So now I'm going to show you guys the Hall of Flowers here. This is the main display area with all the different heirlooms on display. It said they have over 4,000 different varieties of heirlooms today. So let's go ahead and show you guys around. I'm not gonna like read off every single variety because I'll be here all night because there's so many to go over. But I do wanna give you guys a general overview of this building here. It's huge. We look at all the different heirlooms, lots of squashes, melons, tomatoes, and of course, every year they got the good old pile o' pumpkins right here. So I'm just gonna go ahead and take you on a tour just to show you guys what it would have been like here. This is actually the Soda Rock Farms tomato display. Some peppers also. All kinds of heirloom tomatoes. Man, each of these tomatoes taste entirely different, and man, they would be so delicious to eat. Next, of course, we've got my favorite compost company, Sonoma Compost. They have a little display here. This is an excellent use of the back of a pickup truck to grow your own food in. I actually have seen a truck garden before, and oh, look, man. There's some ripe figs on that tree right there. All right, so another part of the Heirloom Expo they do every year is a giant pumpkin contest. Kind of sad that some of the pumpkins don't look as big as they were last year, but still these guys are huge. I'm gonna show them to you guys really quick, and check it out, man. They're not using chemical fertilizers to grow these pumpkins here. They're using good old tried and true methods of, you know, basically creating good flora and nutrients in the soil to grow these babies. Also, they got some good, really good seed stock. I'm really curious on how the seeds inside these pumpkins look, if they're just regular size or if they're like gigantic seeds. I'd love to eat some, actually. But yeah, you can see here a 1,000-pound pumpkin. That's definitely a lot of food. 1,100 pounds. Man. And actually, some of the shapes are really cool on these guys. Another cool thing they're doing this year is the giant vegetable contest. So I want to show you guys this. And I want you guys to participate next year. You know, I know if you're doing some of the techniques that I share with you guys on my show, I know you guys could grow some huge vegetables. And here's some tomatoes here. Do you have a larger tomato than this? This is actually pretty good. I don't know, maybe one of the ones in my garden might be this big, but this is pretty good. I challenge you guys out there. Grow bigger tomatoes than this. What you want to do to get these large tomatoes right, I'll totally tell you how right now. You want to work on the soil microbiology. Most important thing, the beneficial microbes in the soil. You want to get the mycorrhizae in there. You want to get the rock dust, different kinds of rock dust. The fulvic acid, the humic acid, super important. And of course, the worm gold plus worm castings. Some good compost. Fungal dominated compost, super important. That's often left out, as well as the standard, you know, thermal-based compost, and you'll be having some tomatoes this large or larger. And when you enter next year, say, hey, yeah, I'll learn how to grow this large because John at Growing Your Greens saw his video. All right, so if you were here at the Heirloom Expo, you would get a chance to bid on the silent auction. This is the largest silent auction that I've ever seen them have. I mean, they got cool stuff like, you know, fermentation books by Sandor Katz. This dude is the god of fermentation. Recommend his stuff highly. You could also bid on a fermentation crock pot, and seeds and all different kinds of cool stuff. But I'm not here to share with you guys what you missed by not coming, because I want you guys to be here next year. What I want to show you guys is actually what's next door. And what's next door is all the school kids garden displays. So this is kind of like, you know, that science, you know, whatever contest that you'd enter, science fair. Yeah, that's a science fair that you used to enter when you're a kid. But this is all like with gardening stuff put on by different schools. You know, here's a little cookbook that one of the schools put on. And you know, I could sit here and show you everything, but I'm gonna pick out like the top favorite three ones. I mean, this is some of the different things that the schools are growing and they're sharing, and the teachers are educating the kids, and the kids hopefully are going home and even educating their parents. So I wanna stop right there. You know, if you do have kids right now, I think it's super critical and very important to get them involved with gardening that you're getting involved with, and get them, more importantly, learning where the food comes from, like out of the ground, and getting them involved with preparing it and making it and eating it in the home. I mean, the kids are the future. It's too late for many people out there, but you could start with the kids and making changes in them now so they know what real food is, because it's a really sad fact that most kids would think foods come from McDonald's or the grocery store, but not Mother Earth, you know, where food all originated. Everything that we eat has originally come some way from Mother Earth. So one of my favorite booths in this area is actually a booth called Think Out of the Cup, and it's thinkoutofthecup.org. And what they're teaching people and teaching kids is to reuse instead of recycle. And you can reuse that coffee cup if you guys are still drinking Starbucks, which I don't recommend. So that's really bad. You should drink some fresh juice instead. But you could reuse that cup to grow some plants in. So if you do drink at Starbucks, bring it home. And let me show you guys how to do this, because I've never seen this before. Super uber cool. Number one, you're going to start off with a standard cup, a lid, and a napkin, preferably a clean napkin, and some seeds. You're gonna go ahead and fold the napkin up just like in quarters, right? Super simple, no tricks up my sleeve, folded in quarters. Next thing you're gonna do is you're gonna take that napkin that's folded into quarters and you're gonna cut one piece off. So you got a flag, this is American flag on the moon. All right, maybe not. And then you're gonna take the lid and you're just gonna basically, through the hole in the lid right there, you're gonna shove this little napkin through the hole in the lid just like this. All right, pack it in there. Oh, it's too big, it won't fit. Okay, wait, we got it. All right, check it out. Super simple, super easy. All right, so step number four, as you guys can see, the napkin actually wicks up the water from down below, makes the napkin nice and saturated. Next, you're just gonna go ahead and put a handful of potting soil onto the lid and napkin. Check it out. Super cool, super easy. The napkin wicks it up into the potting soil. This potting soil is nice and wet. So step number six, place two tomato seeds or any other kind of seeds in here. And basically they're gonna germinate because the potting soil is nice and wet, and it's gonna grow into a little small baby plant that you could then plant out in a container outside in your raised bed garden or just in a larger pot. Finally, the heirloom tomato plant will grow in a windowsill in 40 days, now ready to transplant. And look at this, we have a nice little beauty there. And that's how easy it is to use a cup to grow some food. Now, once you have your tomato transplanted out, if you don't have a yard to plant it in, don't worry. They have another easy solution. All you need to do is get one of those little storage totes that you put underneath your bed to store your shoes in. Instead of storing your shoes, you can actually put a bag of compost. So here's a good bag of Eco Scraps potting soil in a Rubbermaid tote here. And all they simply did was simply just rip out some holes in there, and they planted the plants inside there. And check it out, man. Put this in a nice sunny space, maybe in your patio or whatever. You have an instant little container garden. Nice and easy. And they got a number of things in there. They got about six different things growing in there at this time. So yeah, definitely a cool little display by Think Out of the Cup. Another cool booth is a booth right here. It's actually the St. Helena Montessori School. If you live in St. Helena, you wanna go there every Friday at the farmer's market and look at all this bounty of fruit and vegetable deliciousness, including I see some sun and moon stars, watermelon that I wanna eat right now, because I'm quite hungry actually, haven't had breakfast. But yeah, I think it's great, especially with kids, Montessori schools, to teach the kids about farming. I'm definitely gonna send either homeschool my kids one day or send them to a school that has farming programs, or I'm gonna start one in the school, damn it. And I wanna encourage you guys out there that are parents, you know, to talk to the teachers about starting programs, about getting the kids gardening. I mean, they have funds available through the Heirloom Expo, you know, if they make a profit every year, the part of the proceeds go to supporting school gardens and teaching the kids about the gardens. All right, so as you guys can see, there's so many other gardening displays. Here's Annley High School here in Santa Rosa, and so many others. Let's go ahead and maybe pick out another one or two for you guys to share with that I really like. All right, so another one of my cool booths that I like for the schools is Grant School in Petaluma, California. They're doing some cool stuff. They got a whole display here on seeds. You know, they're germinating, you know, just little radish seeds in little trays here, and maybe even growing some microgreens or some radishes. They got a, you know, little test on, you know, doing things with seeds and letting them sprout. And actually those are little, some like heirloom lentils. But this is the cool thing I've never seen before. They're sprouting oat seeds in a very unique way. You can see here, it's like a little cup with all these straws, and it has a, like a child's name on each one. And this is Daniel Shaw, number 9. You're now famous on Growing Your Greens. All right, so anyways, what they're doing here is they simply just took a straw, right? I know you guys got straws. They took some kind of like a napkin or paper towel, preferably, rolled it up, shoved it in there, right? And they put a little seed. This is an oat seed in there. And what happens is there's water in the bottom of this cup. The water wicks up, gets the oat seed, gets it wet so that it germinates. And then when it starts to grow, they're probably just gonna go ahead and cut this straw off and, you know, or pop this little seed out and plant it. So yeah, definitely a cool technique. Actually, I've never seen them before. And what other applications can you use straws for germinating seeds? I don't know. I'll have to think about that for a while. Maybe it's a fun side experiment, or maybe this might be useful to some of you guys out there. And that's why I do my show, to pick out this unique and cool stuff I've never seen before. So now we're at the school display of Lewis Opportunity School, and I like this display because I really like the hands-on displays. You know, if you want me to stop at your booth, have a hands-on display that I can get my hands dirty, touch, instead of just looking at pictures. And I like this one a lot because they're teaching not only about the different crops they're growing, and they're growing some cool ones, but they're teaching about compost, something very important for every gardener, I believe every gardener should be doing. They're showing what the starting compost looks like, leaves and whatnot, and then what the finished compost looks like, you know, and they encourage you to pick it up and smell your compost like you smell a fine wine. This is some fine compost there. And then the next stage, besides just the standard compost, is also teaching about worm composting. And then this is basically the worm compost and how this comes out, much different texture, a little bit more wet. There's actually still worms in here in the bottom. I don't know if you guys could see them guys moving in there. It's got a nice, more earthy tone, a little bit more wet. Worm casting is one of the most nutritious things that you should be putting in your garden, in my opinion, even more valuable than standard compost that you're generating. And probably the thing that I came over here the most to show you guys is this. This is something I've actually never seen in person before, and you guys won't be able to get a too super good shot, but they have a little shot glass here of a worm cocoons. So the worm cocoons are basically like worm eggs, for lack of a better word. And I know if you're a wormologist or whatever, you're like, John, that's not what it is. Anyways, I'm saying it, worm eggs, that's what they are. They're worm cocoons. They're not like eggs, but they're close enough. And basically, I've never seen these worm eggs or worm cocoons up close. So like they put it in here so you actually could wiggle this around and look. And I mean, if you look, man, if you look hard, you could actually see, oh yeah, those are the cocoons. They look a little bit different than just small specks of dirt. So now it's cool to be able to see these. And now when I see them in my garden, I'll be able to identify them. They look like little specks of dirt, but they're like not quite as dark. And they kind of look like a small, like micro snail shell, but they're solid. That's probably the best description I could give you guys, because I'm sure the camera's not gonna be able to get a good close-up on this shot. But yeah, worm cocoons, something new to me, and I got to see them for the first time thanks to Lewis Opportunity. All right, so the last school booth that I'm gonna share with you guys is a high school booth, and this would make a great high school project for a high school kid in your family, or maybe for one of you guys out there, is to make a sun-operated dehydrator. So there's many different plans on the online, on YouTube, that you could find and whatnot. Here's just a very simple design for a sun or solar dehydrator. Super cool. Basically, they just got some, it's like 3x3 legs. You can use some 2x4s with some plywood here. And basically, it looks like they got like two trays in here. I might put more than two trays, maybe three or four. But basically, they got a glass here. The glass goes ahead and goes through here and heats this up. They've got in the back, they've basically got a wall with some screen on it to let some of the hot air out. And then you got a flip down back so you can actually pull out the screens. And then they got a temperature in there so you can check out the temperature. I mean, this is how simple a dehydrator can be. You don't need any plug-in appliances, man. We got the sun, nature's dehydrator, man. Out in the desert in Las Vegas, figs will dry on the tree. You know, jujube fruits will dry on the tree without even having to put it in a dehydrator. But I know many of you guys may live in a place, might be humid and whatnot, things won't dehydrate as easily outside. So definitely using a dehydrator like this, or even a plug-in one, definitely a beneficial way and probably one of the best ways, aside from fermentation, that you could preserve your food for the winter. All right, so on this side of the building, basically we have a whole nice heirloom art display going on. We're not gonna look too much at the art display, but it's definitely really cool. And there's all kinds of heirlooms decorating everywhere. These are just some of the decorative displays. And then if we go over here, this is what we're going to show you guys next. Look at all these heirlooms. There's over 4,000 heirlooms in this room right here. All different kinds of pumpkins, squashes. It's insane, all the varieties that are in existence and are being shown here. And once again, you know, they each have a unique flavor, each have unique taste, each grow better or worse in some climates, each will yield more or less, and you're only going to find out which one does the best for you if you start growing a handful of them each year to see which ones you like the best, which ones grow the best, and which ones yield the most for you. I mean, yeah, some of these shapes and sizes are completely really cool. Actually, I kind of like these. These are actually known as the nest egg. Nice, small squash there. And yeah, so many different kinds. I just don't have time to go through them all. Oh wait, here's one. This one might have been out of the 70s, man. It's known as the disco squash. Woohoo! Squashes, I believe, are an excellent food, especially for many of you guys where it snows in the wintertime. You could grow plenty of these winter squashes and let them grow out, and they will store for months and months through the winter. You'll have plenty of food to eat, and of course some are better storage ones than others. Wow, these ones are huge. Look at these guys. But yeah, and just make a really good carbohydrate food source for the winter, really rich in nutrients. And I want to encourage you guys, when growing some of these squashes out, is, you know, choose the squashes when you cut them open that are nice, deep and rich, colorful colors. So, you know, I've seen squashes that are really nice, vibrant oranges and yellows. And I know for a fact these bananas, I mean, that's a lot of food right there to feed somebody. Really nice and pigmented, really nice and sweet flavor as well. So yeah, the squash is definitely a really good source of food for you when you cannot grow food in the wintertime. So yeah, start growing a number of squashes every year and save them for the winter, and, you know, keep records of how some of these store, because some definitely store better than others. A good storage squash for me in the past has been the good old butternut squash that stores fairly well for months and months and months. And of course, you want to keep them in a nice cellar where they're going to stay cool and not too moist so they don't rot out. And yeah, man, all these squashes can be used for food, right? More squashes. And wow, look at this one, man. This one's a really warty. It's got a lot of warts, but don't worry, we can't get diseases from plants. So if you eat that squash, you're not gonna get warts on your feet, your hands, or anywhere else on your body. Let's see. Okay, now we're getting into something really cool, something that I'd rather eat instead of squashes myself, and that's the watermelons. They have over 100 varieties of watermelons here, and other kinds of melons, and so many different kinds. Big ones, small ones, pink ones, orange ones, yellow ones. They all taste a little bit different. And yeah, even ones that aren't even green on the outside. Here's a dark green one on the outside, watermelon 4158. This one's just called Royal Golden. So many different kinds, and every watermelon has a little bit different flavor. I kind of personally like the ones that are different, like the oranges and the yellows. I think they even have some white watermelons here. And I personally prefer my watermelons with the seeds. You know, the ones without the seeds are hybridized, and I prefer to eat watermelon with the seeds whenever possible. And if you're buying watermelon in the stores these days, unfortunately most of them seem to come without the seeds. So it's a very important reason to grow your own, to save the genetic diversity, to spread the seeds out to people once you grow some of these watermelons out. And also, there's actually really good nutrients in the seeds. Many of you guys may not know this, but you guys could actually eat watermelon seeds. They're quite good. Actually, just recently last year, I bought a watermelon seed sheller. So if you crack open a watermelon, in the middle of the black watermelon seed will be a little white kernel. That's actually quite delicious. And there's one seller at the health food store that sells actually whole watermelon seeds that are sprouted. They are absolutely delicious. A really good rich source of fat. So if you get hungry in the wintertime, you could break out your watermelon seeds and start eating them for some extra protein, some extra nutrients, and some extra calories. Yeah, just going through all these watermelons makes me quite hungry. Oh, look at this one. This one's called the Tender Gold. Look at the coloring on that, man. We'll compare the coloring on that with the Blacktail Mountain right next door. It'll get a nice dark red, nice vibrant orange color. So one of the coolest things at the Heirloom Expo is the annual seed exchange they do every Thursday. This is the last day where people bring their seeds and exchange them. See this gentleman here, he's brought tons of seeds that he's been saving, and this is a very important aspect of heirlooms and saving and passing on the genetic diversity. All right, so besides just a seed swap, they're also giving away some of the seeds to help people and start this seed swap, because if nobody shows up to the seed swap, and nobody shows up with seeds, this can't ever get started. So, you know, wherever you live, it's always good to share your seeds. If you see a good deal on seeds, like I often see good deals on seeds at the end of the season. I just bought seeds actually for like 50 cents a pack at a health food store up in Albany, New York, where I was visiting. And I like walked away with, I don't know, 20 packs of seeds for like 10 bucks. So now I have extra seeds to share with others or for me to grow out. Seeds are one of the most valuable things, you know, in gardening and in farming, and once again preserving the diversity. So they're giving a lot of different varieties of seeds out. They got tomatoes and peppers and eggplants, but let me share with you guys the ones I'm getting today. And they said you could get up to 5 packs. So I'm getting the radish Chinese green luobo. You know, I love to grow radishes, especially in the winter time. They do well. Another one that I'm going to grow in the winter, of course, are these guys, beets. These are albino beets. It's like you've seen them albino people in some of those movies. These are albino beets, so they're white, and actually they kind of look like they got some rings on the inside. Really cool. Once again, gonna grow in the winter, so I'm getting ready for my upcoming fall winter season. In addition, of course, I love my celery. We got some tender crisp celery we're gonna grow. These ones readily and easily reseed in my garden. So I mean, you get celery seeds once. I have so many celery seeds in my garden, it's not even funny. Then I got some, of course, for next year, summertime. Got the cucumber dragon's egg. This is a nice like lemon style cucumber, but it's completely white, really tender and mild. And then of course I got a little cool petite melon, melon rich sweetness 132. Very refreshing, and it just sounds so sweet, and I can't wait to eat them next year. Now we're gonna go ahead and share with you guys a really quick tour of Demeter's biodynamic garden here at the Heirloom Expo. I have a specific video that I'll put a link down below. So you could check out the full tour. Like 2 years ago when I was here, I did a really good full tour on it. This year, I'm just gonna kind of walk around and point out a few things that I like that they're showing in their garden this year. So there's so many things to see in this biodynamic area. One of the things I really wanna show you guys, and something I'm passionate about, are the bees. As you guys can see, they have different kinds of hives, and these aren't just your standard Langstroth hives. They got a hive made out of a log, literally. I mean, this is where bees used to live before we had hives. And then they got actually a straw hive, which is kind of cool. It's very akin to similar to a top bar. They got 20 basically rails in there. Then they got a basket hive here out of a basket. This was traditionally used in some cultures in the world. And they got also a sun hive made out of like some kind of straw and some other natural materials. And it's my opinion, of course, according to the sign, it says living with bees, without bees, there is no fertility. Bees, you know, pollinate like 30% of the crops, and without the bees, you guys wouldn't be eating, you know, a lot of the different foods, especially the fruits that are eaten today. And I want to encourage the backyard gardeners to start incorporating, you know, bees and grow some bee-friendly plants, including edibles, that, you know, you'll give them some habitat, because their habitat is quickly disappearing. And you know, a lot of people are spraying things on their gardens that basically wipe out the bees. So, you know, grow organically, don't spray toxins, and all these kind of things, and provide some habitat for the bees so that they can flourish, and you will flourish too. So now we're looking at another area of Demeter's garden, and this is a nice little food forest here behind me. And one of the things I wanted to point out in this area that's probably one of the most important sayings in this whole, you know, area is right here. Healthy soil means healthy plants, means healthy people. So you really want to focus your efforts on, if you're a gardener, whether you're a gardener or farmer actually, on the soil. The soil builds the planetary health. I mean, we could even go beyond healthy people to healthy planets, right? And the soils are being degraded at a very fast rate with rainforest destruction, with, you know, tilling and all these crazy things that people are doing these days for modernization. So I really, as gardeners, for you guys out there watching this, I really guys want you guys to focus on building your soil. Not growing the biggest or healthiest plants, but build your soil, and the healthy, large plants with lots of yields will come. I think I want to share with you guys one more area in this Demeters Biodynamic Garden, and it's up right here. All right, so now I thought I'd share with you this cool little flow form here, and it's all made out of plastic. Many of the flow forms here are actually made out of stone or concrete. And this is really cool. I did show this on my preview episode. I want to come back and figure out what it is and what it's doing. Basically, it energizes the water. It runs the water through special forms, swirls it, vortexes it, makes it alive, changes the structure. And actually what it is specifically, it's a compost tea kit. This is one expensive compost tea kit. It's, I think, over $1,500. It's made in New Zealand. I think it's definitely really cool, but I'm not that rich to be affording one of these anytime soon. But I think this is definitely a good way, you know, if you have a large farm, need to do different preparations, you know, investing in one of these guys to swirl your water and make your compost tea. I'd really love to test compost tea made in this versus compost tea made with a standard bubbler. I definitely know that this one's gonna be a lot easier to clean. All right, so this is a food area here at the Heirloom Expo. There's so many different choices of food, but I'm glad that they're using a lot of local heirloom and organic foods here in the food area. Of course, for me, I brought all the food that I'm eating, most of it out of my garden actually, and making watermelon juice instead of drinking water at the booth every day. And I always encourage you guys to, whenever you can, even if you travel, you know, bring the foods you ate. What that means, you're gonna dehydrate them, or even better yet, ferment them, like one of the booths right here. So let me go ahead and share one of the food booths, my favorite food booth here at this event. And if you come next year, you're definitely gonna wanna visit them as well. All right, so the one food booth that I wanna share with you guys today that I really like here is actually called Farm to Ferments. And I like this because they're fermenting foods. And I wanna encourage you guys as gardeners out there to ferment your own foods. But if you're kind of lazy like me sometimes and you're traveling, you know, it's excellent to get some fermented foods. Fermented foods are a wealth of nutrition. They have the beneficial probiotics, and all the fruits and vegetables you're growing in your garden are prebiotics. They even feed the probiotics. But to culture these probiotics or the beneficial microbes, they help colonize your gut and help digest your food and comprise part of your immune system. And they definitely have some amazing ferments here. Some of the ones that I've never even heard before, one called Curdita, which is a El Salvadorian ferment that's off the hook, my favorite one by far. They got a fermented hot sauce, really rare to see fermented hot sauce. They got fermented, you know, juices and pickled juices from the juices from making some of these different ferments. And today what I'm gonna get for dinner is actually, it's called a pickle plate they're offering here. $6 and an heirloom cabbage leaf with all these amazing ferments. And check it out, this is the best deal at the whole place. Look at that, looks beautiful. This is live, living food, never heated, minimally processed. And we're gonna go ahead and try it. I think I found my dinner. So the reason why I like the pickled plate here and the fermented foods is because of the umami flavors that they have. This is like a Japanese word that they made for like a flavor that you don't normally get in regular foods. And this really satisfies my palate when I'm eating dinner. And that's why I use some fermented foods mostly every night in what I'm making, like in my soup or my salad dressing that I'm making. Definitely put some good stuff. They're doing it right here. They're sustainable. They're getting locally sourced organic produce and all this stuff. And it's just literally two brothers that are doing some awesome work. And so you can learn more about them next year at the Heirloom Expo, support them, or visit them at other local farmers markets. Hopefully they'll be in Whole Foods one of these days. And you can learn more about them at farmtoferments.com. So the next area I wanna share with you guys at the Heirloom Expo is actually the GMO alley is what I'm gonna call it. And actually here's a sign, it says glyphosate found in mom's breast milk. Glyphosate is basically Roundup, and they make the GMO crops Roundup ready, which means they can be sprayed the shitload with the glyphosate or the Roundup and still grow and produce food. But these chemicals, as found in mom's breast milk, is still pertaining after the food is grown and we consume and eat it. So the question is, what does that glyphosate do to the mom, and more importantly, the kids of the future? Well, there's a lot of research on that, but I guess without further ado, let's go into the GMO alley and share with you guys some of the facts that they're sharing here today about GMOs, your health, and the health of the world. So in GMO Alley here, they have a lot of different educational type displays, including this one here, one next door, and a whole bunch of other information about GMOs. And I like that they make it fun, especially for the kids, to educate the kids about what GMOs are. So I'm gonna be a kid right now and have some fun. They got these bean bags, and just like those old fairs where you have to knock down the the clowns or something and win a prize. We're gonna knock down some targets here and learn about GMOs. And so let's see, I'm gonna go ahead and try to throw it on the one on the cotton. It says 94% of the cotton grown in the United States is genetically engineered, 2014.
All right.
All right, oh, check it out. 80% of processed foods contain GMOs. This is one excellent reason why I believe you guys should avoid processed foods, to not support GMOs, not put them in your body. I think it's very important to eat whole, natural, and real foods, especially the ones you guys are growing. Let's see if we could knock down another square. Let's see here. All right, I'm gonna go for this one. It says, new genetically engineered Roundup Ready bluegrass coming to a lawn, drifting into an organic pasture near you. And basically it's just talking about how animals are now eating GMOs and then we're eating the animals. Not a good thing. Definitely want to encourage you guys to eat more things out of your yard. Fruits and vegetables, they're the best. All right, check it out. USDA approved GMO alfalfa coming to a granary near you. And so now all the livestock that are, you know, eating alfalfa would now be eating GMO alfalfa. And let me remind you that, you know, cows and animals and chickens are already eating GMO corn, GMO soy. Most of the GMO corn and soy actually end up for livestock feed. And then you're eating it secondhand, in my opinion. I would never do that to myself, my wife, when I have one, or my family. All right, we got one last bean bag. Let's see what we can knock over. Oh, it says, I'm gonna go for that one. It says 89% of the corn in the United States is genetically engineered. And we're gonna go ahead and throw the bean bag. Oh, I blew it. All right, let's go knock it down. Boom. All right, it says, check it out. GMO corn produces BT toxin and an insecticide in every cell of the plant. The corn itself was registered with the EPA as an insecticide from 1996 to January 2014. The same insecticide is still in every cell. It's in everything. And as you guys can see, if you're eating Doritos or, you know, burrito shells, corn and vegetable oil, you know, candies that have corn syrup, you know, soda that has corn syrup, corn starch, high fructose corn syrup in rats cause obesity. Maybe that's why we have an overweight challenge and obesity problem in the US, because people are eating the stuff with the GMO corn syrup in there, you know, and of course things like corn. So once again, I want to encourage you guys to get these foods out of your diet, things with corn syrup, read your ingredient labels, and you know, the easiest thing to do is just stick with a whole foods diet. Try to eat as much as you can grow and eat the things you grow and eat out of your yard and your garden instead of the grocery store. I'm John Cullen, I'm the master of disguise. Well, actually I'm trying to play the corn who's the master of disguise, because the whole thing is that the corn and the BT that's in the corn, genetically modified, is hiding in so many different foods in your supermarket. You may even have these in your cupboard. And one of the things I want you guys to do is vote with your dollars. If you're against GMOs, you need to stop buying them so then the people stop making them. Also, you guys need to vote for GMO labeling so less people can be aware of the GMOs in the food and have the choice to buy them and consume them if they want or if they don't want to. And so here's a list of hundreds of different foods that have GMO in there, such as beverages and margarine and powdered sugar and puddings and salad dressings. You know, basically, you want to get the processed foods out of your diet. Eat whole, real, and natural foods. All right, next, the last area I want to show you guys in this GMO alley is actually over here, where they actually have some of the different documentation on how GMOs can adversely affect your health. So in this display, what they're trying to explain is some interesting correlations, you know, that happened basically with the increase in more higher incidences of the GMO crops or the glyphosate with health. And so here's some correlations with different cancers. You can see the cancer rate goes up with glyphosate use, as well as, you know, things like the high blood pressure going up and hospitalization for kidney injury, as well as other things. Now, I want to let you guys know that, you know, correlation does not mean causation, but it's kind of peculiar that these things are all going up about at the same time. To learn more information about this, you want to check out examiner.com and to look up Swanson 2013. You should be able to find these articles to learn more if you're interested. I got me a tractor. Just kidding. All right. So anyways, we're here at the end of the 2014 National Heirloom Expo. I barely got any time to make videos because I was so busy meeting people, talking to people, giving my presentations and just trying to go around and hear some of the speakers myself. I only actually got the one speaker who talked about worm castings and how important worm castings and worms are to the health of the soil, the health of the plants, but more importantly, the health of the planet. So yeah, I want to encourage all you guys out there to make your own worm castings, have your own pet worms. They're definitely gonna add lots of nutrients to your soil. But yeah, I mean, I got to barely show you anything in this episode. I mean, the only thing I'm gonna say is that they are doing it again in 2015. Be sure to mark your calendars, beginning of September 2015, and come out to the 2015 Heirloom Expo, because I just simply cannot show you guys what it's truly like to be here, because I'm just so busy meeting viewers that are just expressing their gratitude for the work that I do, and I'm so glad you guys are my viewers out there. Be sure to subscribe to my videos if you're not already for upcoming episodes where I share some of the other things I've done here at the Heirloom Expo, but also because of the knowledge that I've gained during this expo, I'll be able to share this in future episodes for you guys. So yeah, that's pretty much it. My voice is about gone. Everybody's packing up, going home, and I need to do the same. It's been an amazing last 3 days I've had here. This is some of the funnest times of my life. In any case, hope you guys enjoyed this episode. Once again, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time, and until then, keep on growing.